Good morning and welcome to the 8th meeting of the Public Audit and Post-Legislative Scrutiny Committee. Can I ask all those present to switch off their electronic devices or switch them to silent mode so they do not affect the work of the committee? Item number one, the committee is invited to agree to take item three in private. Item three is consideration of evidence received under item two on the audit of the Scottish Government's consolidated accounts. Do members agree to take item three in private? Yes. Thank you. Item two is an evidence session on the Auditor General's for Scotland's report, the 2015-16 audit of the Scottish Government consolidated accounts. I welcome to the meeting Caroline Gardner, Auditor General for Scotland, Mark Taylor, Assistant Director, and Gordon Small, Senior Manager at Audit Scotland. I now invite the Auditor General to make her opening statement before I open up to questions.
Thank you, Convener. The Scottish Parliament's financial powers are increasing, with new responsibilities coming for taxes and spending. The Government's budget and accounts for 2015-16 reflected for the first time the new tax and borrowing powers set out in the Scotland Act 2012. With further powers now flowing from the Scotland Act 2016, our public finances are becoming increasingly complex. Transparency in budgets and in financial reporting to support scrutiny and decision making has never been more important. The consolidated accounts are a central component of the Government's accountability to Parliament and the public. They cover around 90% of the spending approved by Parliament in 2015-16, the elements that the Government is directly responsible for. They show the amount spent against each main budget heading and the reasons for any significant differences. They also show the assets, liabilities, and other financial commitments carried forward to future years. I prepare a Section 22 report on the Scottish Government's accounts each year to highlight significant matters arising from the accounts and to support the committee's scrutiny, reflecting the central role of the accounts and the scale of the change that's now underway. My report sets out how the consolidated accounts relate to the Scottish budget as a whole and the new powers being introduced, and highlights the main financial management issues for the Government during the year. Convener, it's important to state for the record that my independent opinion on the consolidated accounts is unqualified. This means that they provide a true and fair view of the Government's finances. I would like to highlight three areas from my report. First of all, financial management and reporting. The Scottish Government managed its budget for 2015-16 within the overall limit set by Parliament, and budget management during the year was effective in managing total spending. The accounts meet the relevant legal and accounting requirements, and I welcome the steps the Government is taking to improve its accounts, to develop commentary on its financial position, and to explain how other accounts, like the devolved taxes account prepared by Revenue Scotland, are linked. As the new powers are introduced, though, there's a lot to do to ensure that the Parliament and the public have got the information they need to fully understand and to scrutinise spending priorities and plans, how public money was spent, and what was achieved. I'm particularly pleased to note the commitment in the Permanent Secretary's letter to the committee, signalling the production of the consolidated public account for audit in spring 2018. We will, of course, work with the Scottish Government to support this important process. Secondly, on performance, the consolidated accounts contain a performance report which complies with the principles of the Government reporting requirements. The emphasis is on financial performance against budget, with signposts to where more performance information is available, for example, in the National Performance Framework. There remains scope for the Government to develop its annual reporting to provide a more extensive analysis of its overall performance. A common theme that comes from my performance audit work is the potential for better alignment of plans and funding with the National Performance Framework. We also often find that plans for implementing policy and reforming public services lack important measures of progress. More clarity is needed to support Parliament in its scrutiny and accountability role. Finally, Convener, I'd like to highlight two specific matters arising from the 2015-16 consolidated accounts. First of all, the impact of the Office for National Statistics classification decision on the Aberdeen peripheral western route on the capital budget and borrowing plans in 2015-16. And secondly, the position on the European Structural Funds programme, leading to a permanent loss of grant to the Scottish Government. The committee's evidence session on the Government's consolidated accounts is an important milestone in scrutiny of the Government's finances. My report on the 2015-16 audit is intended to support this process, as well as scrutiny and accountability in the Parliament's work more generally. The government has a good record of financial management and reporting, governance arrangements are generally effective, and the national performance framework is well established. Together, these form a strong basis for the developments that are still needed to meet the challenges ahead. As always, Convener, we're happy to answer the committee's questions.
Thank you very much, Auditor General. I'll now open to questions. The first question is from Alison Harris.
Good morning, Auditor General. Now, this is just actually out of interest, purely interest. You know, I've noticed that this is an unqualified audit report and it's too unfair. In your experience, has there ever been anything else?
I think for the Scottish Government's consolidated account, for the last 11 years, the opinion has been unqualified. I've been in post for 4 years, so I'd be struggling to talk to you about the reasons before that, but clearly it's a long track record.
Out of interest, yeah. I was just asking. Uh-huh. Yes, no, it was really in relation to the performance reporting. Now, obviously, you know, I've noted what you've said. You know, my concern is that there doesn't seem to be, you know, an overall picture. You know, an overall picture of the Scottish Government as a whole. You know, and how can we actually monitor and measure the progress really without this? Is there anything that you're aware of that's coming into place that might help that?
I think the point about how we link what the government spends with what it plans to achieve and what it actually achieves is one of the key messages coming out of my report on the accounts this year. As I say in the report, the Scottish Government's annual report does comply with requirements in having a performance report in there. That talks mainly about financial performance and then signposts the reader to other sources of information like the National Performance Framework. Now, that's a decent starting point, but I do think there's scope for bringing the two more closely together. You'll be very aware as an accountant that the financial performance is only one half of a picture, and you need to be tying the two together, and we think there's more room to be making those links more explicit and drawing out the overall picture, particularly the links between the money that's spent and what it's spent on and the impact on the outcomes that the government is trying to improve.
Yes, no, that's very true. The other bit that just I was looking at was in relation to European funding. And do you have any idea, because what's concerning me, you know, if 3 out of 4 were suspended, in fact, 4 out of 4 ultimately at the end when the fourth was interrupted, sorry, is the correct word to use, to avoid any errors that have been made in the past, have you any idea about any implementation of any management control systems to try and ensure that, you know, the government does receive the full value from the EEC projects?
Yes, I think it's important to say, first of all, that the problems that were encountered a bit further down the spending chain in the bodies that were spending money, receiving grant funding and spending money on the government's behalf.
Right.
But obviously it's clear that the Scottish Government does have accountability for the controls that are in place right through the chain. I'll ask Mark to talk you through the action that's being taken there.
Thank you.
Yeah, as the Auditor General explained, the concerns arise from how the whole system's been managed through time. Yeah. And the European Commission's been working with the government to do two things. One is to address the spending in that period, and that's what led to the £14 million estimated loss of grant funding, but also to think about what the control system is going forward and what the control should be going forward. And the government's put in place plans that it thinks to address the concerns of the Commission. The system allows the auditor in that case it's the Internal Audit Service of the Scottish Government, to do some work around that, and they've done some work and continue to do some work to help ensure that that new control system, the improvements that are being put in place, are the ones that they're actually applied in practice.
Right, so there are now new controls in place moving forward?
There is a new control system in place. The effectiveness of that still needs to be tested.
Right, okay. But certainly it should be more effective with it in place than not in place. Yes. Okay, thank you. I'll move over to somebody else. Thank you.
Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Convener. I also had some similar interest to Alison Harris around performance and outcomes. Auditor General, in I think paragraph 54 of the report, you talk about potential for greater alignment of resources and actions. And I just wondered if you'd say a little more about that, given we've had a response from Leslie Evans, but what are the opportunities to do this in terms of aligning resources, and is there anything in the response that gives you some confidence that they were more on track towards that?
We mentioned one example here in the report in paragraph 54 about the link between the government's economic strategy and the actions and activities undertaken by Scottish Enterprise, Highlands and Islands Enterprise and others, where it's not easy to link directly through, to trace how what the agencies are doing and how they're tracking their progress is expected to improve the outcomes in the government's economic strategy, and what changes are being made if things aren't moving in the right direction. An example that might be closer to the committee's experience at the moment, I think, is around the NHS and social care, where in my report last week, one of the common themes was that some of the measures that are being used to hold health boards to account around acute service targets and the annual financial targets aren't clearly linked to the overall aim of having everybody able to live happier, healthy lives at home or close to home. So it's making those links more explicit and recognising that while outcomes often are very long-term changes that may take a generation to have an impact, in the short term you need to know whether you're moving in the right direction or not. So having those interim measures and milestones of where you expect to be across a longer period is what we're looking for. The National Performance Framework is widely recognised as being a really good development, but I think it won't have its full effect until it's fully linked up to the everyday spending plans and strategies and actions that public bodies undertake to know how those outcomes are improving over time.
And do you think having more and better indicators is an effective way to achieve this? Could we be overloaded by indicators, or is there a balance to be struck?
I absolutely recognise the concern behind your question, and I think one of the concerns in health and social care in the past has been that people have felt overloaded by indicators. For me, it's absolutely not about the quantity of them. It's about saying we do need to know we're moving in the right direction, and let's make sure that what we're measuring is measuring the right things. That's not always been the case in the past, and sometimes there is, a gap, a lack of information to let us know whether we're doing what we intend to do. I think Mark wants to add to that.
Thank you.
Just to add to what the Auditor General was saying there, we think there's an opportunity to perhaps set out some more of the interim steps and some clarity about what pots of money are being used to achieve in the shorter term and a way in which that contributes to the outcomes that are desired in the longer term, and a bit of clarity about that, a bit more clarity both in terms of where there's new initiatives and new projects in place, what the milestones are for those projects, but also more generally as services are being developed, how the money's been spent, what it's been used for, and what the outputs are expected to achieve that contributes to those overall outcomes.
Okay, I'm just looking at Annex A, which was attached to the response from Leslie Evans. It looks like, from what we've been told here, that you've welcomed some of the changes, but I was interested to know, it's on page 5 of Annex A, where it says the Scottish Government's made the following improvements to the expenditure reporting, and it says other streaming and simplification has been applied to make the accounts more accessible. The changes have been welcomed by the Auditor General. Are you able to say a little bit about what those changes are, and if you are satisfied that that's sort of job done?
Absolutely. I'll ask Gordon to talk you through that, if I may.
Thank you.
So the accounts themselves, if you've looked at them, it's a very large document. It covers a lot of ground. What we noticed this year was, I think it's, as the Auditor General said earlier, a real step up in improvement in the front end of the accounts that talk about performance, but very much about financial performance. So there's a lot more description and analysis of what the financial position is, performance against budget, and some key elements of what the accounts contain themselves. So we see that as a big improvement. I think it helps understandability and readability of the accounts. There's a lot covered in the accounts. I say it's a complicated document, and that's very helpful. I think it's that next stage about what do we do to link that to the performance, the conversation that we've just been having there. Now, I think our sense is that the accounts meet the requirements, there's no doubt about that. It's where that performance is actually reflected. It may be that there's scope to say more in the accounts themselves. It may be that it's somewhere else, but what we really need is that overall picture. And I think as well, just adding to what colleagues have said so far, there's something about that whole system as well. So in terms of when the budgets are brought forward, what's intended to happen with the money and how it will be spent, and then coming back with, at the end of the year, an outturn, whether it's, I say, in the accounts or elsewhere, to see actually how that money was spent in actuality and what was achieved from that. So long way around, but the short answer is improvements, but still some way to go.
Okay. Just one final point from me, convener. In all countries and in all parliaments, politicians sort of throw big numbers about when we're asked about difficult challenges, and we see overspending X amount more on any particular issue. Is there an example of best practice in other countries, in other jurisdictions where governments do this better? Is there anything we can learn? Because I'm just wondering, do we ever reach a point where the public really know if we're getting value for money, if, you know, life is getting better for people? Is it ever truly possible to learn that from a report?
It's a really good question, and we're not saying this is an easy thing to do right. We've been looking at examples around the world to make sure that we can play our part in thinking about what Scotland needs with the new financial powers. And I think one of the places we've been most impressed by is New Zealand, where, first of all, they do aim to take a preventative approach, like the approach here in Scotland, and one that's focused on outcomes. But I think in many parts of what they do, they've been able to be very rigorous about using some analysis to identify, for example, if you're talking about the criminal justice system, who are the people, the families, the children who are most at risk, mm-hmm. most using services at the moment, what would be needed to help improve their lives in ways that are good for them, but also reduce the demands on the criminal justice system, on social work, on the health service more widely, and then to use their budget planning process to move resources around to be able to do that. They also do very well in the comprehensive budget information they've got that aligns their programmes in those areas with the way money's being spent and moved between budget headings. And they're very transparent in reporting how their money's been spent at the end of the year, but also with monthly monthly accounts that are published to let people see what's happening during the process. In really interesting ways, it seems to be much less politicised than it is here in Scotland and in the UK, and I'm interested in how they achieve that. But in terms of comprehensiveness and transparency, I think there's a lot we can learn there.
That's a very helpful reply. Thank you.
Liam Kerr.
Thank you. Morning. So just looking through, at paragraph 13 is the first thing I want to just inquire about. So you say at that section that the total net expenditure during the year was £33,308 million, which is £392 million less than budgeted. Can you tell me, first of all, what happens to that underspend? Does it in some way get sent down south? Does it get clawed back? Can it get carried over to the following year? What happens to it?
I'm going to ask Mark to talk you through that, and I apologise in advance that it is complicated.
So the best exhibit to refer to is Exhibit 3 on page 9 of the report, which attempts to answer that question essentially, and also aligns very much with the provisional outturn statement that the Cabinet Secretary gave to Parliament in June. The essential kind of challenge is that the consolidated accounts and the budget within Scotland operates to slightly different rules from the Treasury budget, and so there needs to be a reconciliation between the two, and we explain how that works in the report. Essentially, Exhibit 3 sets out the different elements of that underspend as how they apply at a whole budget level, and there's then an explanation of how each of those elements are able to be carried forward or not able to be carried forward. In essence, the ones towards the top of the page are the ones that feature in the outturn statement, provisional outturn statement, and carry forwards in relation to resource, net resource del, capital del, and the financial transactions in general can all be carried forward under budget rules, and also the money that's additional money greater than expected in the devolved taxes is able to be carried forward. There's a couple of elements that aren't able to be carried forward around annual managed expenditure and non-cash del, and those are to do with the nature of those expenditure. Essentially, those don't give the government any additional spending power. Those are technical accounting measures of expenditure, and also annual managed expenditure or expenditure that the Treasury essentially underwrites, and for those reasons they don't affect the overall spending power under the current arrangements for the devolved government. So we are content that all the money all of the underspend that was able to be carried forward has been carried forward through a number of devices, and happy to dip into some of those.
So I think I follow you. There is a significant element of the 392 million that remains available for use, for employment by the Scottish Government. And they can presumably choose. That's not ring-fenced in any way, is it? That could just be applied to a sector that is crying out for money.
So there is a degree of ring fencing in that carry forward. So under the current arrangements, each part of the carry forward has a certain label on it, and the money that's carried forward with that label on it needs to be used for those purposes. Probably the best way to exemplify that is the financial transactions carry forward, the Capital Dale financial transactions, about midway down the table on page 9, and the under-overspend was an underspend of £40 million. And there's an ability of the government to carry forward that money, but to use them only for the purposes of financial transactions, which are essentially loans to help business. And there are certain rules around that. So there is a degree to which the government can decide to apply different elements of the carry forward to different things, but there are elements of that are ring fenced that it needs to manage within.
I understand. So if I was to say, look, there's an extra £392 million there that you can apply to the NHS, for example, that would be far too simplistic an analysis, wouldn't it?
And that would be incorrect. That's not able to be done. Another example is if you look at the carry forward and the reserves and the cash reserve of devolved tax revenues, that can only be used for a very specific purpose in the next year, which is to offset any under recovery of tax against those devolved taxes against forecast next year. With the introduction of the Scotland Reserve from the 1st of April 2017, there's much more freedom around how reserves might be able to be used, but there'll still be rules around different pots of money and what those pots of money are able to be used for.
I understand. At paragraph 25, you talk about the land and buildings transaction tax, residential land and buildings transaction tax revenues being in the lower part of the range forecast, £27 million less than forecast. Purely anecdotally, but there seemed to me up in the northeast to be a drop-off in higher-end sales after the land and buildings transaction tax came in. Are you able to identify, or have you identified, why there's been this shortfall in the forecast? Effectively, has this extra tax depressed the market, in your view?
It's not easy for us to be clear about what's driven changes in the revenues from each of the devolved taxes, and obviously we will have more devolved taxes from April next year. The Scottish Fiscal Commission has published a report on the outturn for 2015-16 against the forecasts which they endorsed that were produced by the Scottish Government. We can certainly refer you to that very readily after the meeting. I think it's worth saying that the first year of a new tax is always complicated because you don't necessarily have good information beforehand. We did have the situation where the Scottish Government's rates were agreed by the Parliament well in advance of the start of the financial year, and there was then a late change in response to measures in the UK Government budget. So there was a lot going on in that year, but the Scottish Fiscal Commission has given their best analysis of what was behind the changes in land and building transaction tax as well as the landfill tax for that year. Do you want to add anything to that, Mark?
I think just a general point I'd make alongside that, without the specific getting into the specifics of that particular tax and the policy decisions around that, is that what's new this year and will be a feature of the Scottish Budget going forward is there'll be a higher level of forecasting of taxes, forecasting of block grant adjustments, forecasting of social security expenditure ultimately. And inevitably with forecasts, those are not accurate predictions of exactly what's going to happen. There will be a degree of uncertainty, and there will always be that degree of uncertainty. And that's a real shift in the nature of financial management and the public finances in Scotland. And it's managing that will be a big challenge. Forecasts can get better, data can get better, we can do what we can, and the Fiscal Commission will be doing what it can to make as accurate a forecast as possible. There's something underlying about the uncertainty around the forecasting process that it will all need to manage and live with as we go forward.
And finally for me, just staying on that page 10, paragraph 27, you talk about the Aberdeen Western Peripheral Route, and I just wanted to understand that a little better. Can you explain this reclassification? And I'm coming at this from perhaps a significant level of ignorance. I had understood that the initial money for the Western Peripheral Route and these sorts of projects wasn't part of the public budget, the public balance sheet, and then for some reason it had to be reclassified onto the national balance sheet. You say in here that it was a decision of the ONS. The ONS decided to reclassify it. But I have in my mind that it was something to do with European regulation or procurement or some such. Can you just clarify that for me, please?
We'll do our best, and both of your understandings are correct. They're part of the picture. The government had initially intended the Aberdeen Western Peripheral Route and a small number of other projects to be effectively off the public sector, the government's balance sheet, and it had it thought initially that the way its financing had been structured would allow that. That would have meant that all of the costs of the project would be met from the revenue budget over a period of years, and there would be no need for cover from the capital budget to get that project and the others underway. The Office for National Statistics has got responsibility for applying the European rules to government projects across the United Kingdom and making sure that they're classified correctly as being either on the public sector balance sheet or off it. They have a programme of projects or initiatives that they intend to review, and the Aberdeen Western Peripheral Route came up in the 2015-16 programme for the ONS, and their decision of that project specifically was that it should be classified as public sector, should therefore be on the balance sheet, and would therefore require budget cover from the Scottish Government's capital budget. The government took the decision itself to apply the same approach, which they felt was prudent, to a handful of other projects, which we list in the report, and that led to a fairly significant call on the government's capital allocation for 2015-16 that it hadn't initially expected. And we try to set that out in the report, but it is, as you say, a complicated picture.
Thank you. And so that means... So the government had to find, effectively, an extra £392 million that it hadn't budgeted for?
I'll ask Gordon to reply to keep me right on the figures, but the principle is correct, yes.
Yes, that's absolutely correct. So as a result, and it's worth just taking back a stage in terms of your question, you're absolutely right. There's a system that's recognised across Europe in terms of how countries deal at national accounts level. It's statistical rather than... international financial reporting standards. So there's a difference again, another complication in there. But as a consequence of that, the roll down and affected the classification of the Aberdeen Western Peripheral Route and then how that went on. You're absolutely right. The government was faced with a fairly significant task in terms of its changing its plans for both capital spending and borrowing, in fact. And so had to accommodate that additional charge against its budget in year, which, as we say in the report, it successfully did. Consequence of that, and it affects the year that we're talking about, 15-16, there'll be an effect in the current financial year as well, as they still deal with that. But it does have an actual effect, and that is about some of the things we've highlighted in the report in terms of reprofiling budgets, stopping doing some things, doing spending further down the line. So there is an actual effect of this on budgets, and as we say, the Scottish Government has successfully managed that in 15-16.
Right. Very quickly, it's presumably complete coincidence that that figure of £392 million is the same as the one we looked at earlier, the underspend.
Absolutely.
And just a very quick question, could that have been foreseen in terms of the reclassification from off-balance sheet to on-balance sheet? Could someone at the planning stage, did no one think when they were putting a risk register or some such together, this could happen?
The first thing to point out is that in terms of the accounting in the Scottish Government's accounts that we're considering today, it complies with all the requirements, so that's done properly, just to make that point absolutely clear. These are very complicated transactions, and when the rules changed, as they did in the European, as I mentioned, the European statistical rules changed, that then has to come through. It then becomes a very an intense and very technical assessment of individual projects, and as Auditor General was saying, the ONS has got a programme that it publishes of things that it will look at and measure against the statistical rules to see whether it's affecting national budgets and the like. So it's a very difficult question. It's one that the when faced with this, the Scottish Government had to react to. It went into negotiations because, as I say, a lot of this is not, you know, cannot. There may be no straightforward answer to things. There has to be a discussion about. It's all about the balance of control of individual projects and where the risks and responsibilities lie. So there are fine judgments in there. So it's a difficult one to answer. I think as the Auditor General says, I think the steps the government took off the back of the decision on the Aberdeen Western Peripheral Route to look at other similar projects and to, if you like, get ahead of that, because these haven't actually been assessed yet, but the government recognises the similarities in the way in which these projects and plans are put together and has applied the same methodology, if you like, in terms of how it rolls through into its budget. So, but these, as I say, there's a programme of work and there are very fine judgments in there as to whether they're on or off in terms of the national account statistics.
I understand. Thank you.
Thank you, Liam. On that point, I mean, this happened to colleges, it's happened to the peripheral route in Aberdeen. Could the ONS reclassify anything else? And are you confident that the Scottish Government is looking right across the public sector to assess the potential impact so we don't see these losses again?
The class is actually classification. So in the case of the Aberdeen Road, it was a classification that wasn't previously, this was the assessment for the first time, if you like, based against these new rules that were coming through the European system of accounts. The ONS has got a programme of work. It looks at various things. For example, more recently, it's been looking at housing associations and whether these are public corporations or not, and the consequences of that. So the government will be well aware of the programme of work that the ONS has got. The government can look at the way in which the relationships are between itself and these other organisations and between the transactions in itself, as we've been discussing around the some of these capital projects. And there are things that the government can do to, if you like, adjust the balances between organisations, between transactions in itself, that can affect that very fine judgment in terms of where things sit. There are consequences of that in terms of the balance of accountability and control, but that's perhaps for a further conversation. Short answer is that there is a programme of work and the government has to deal with things that they come up in. As Mark was saying, this will become more business as usual for the government as things tend to arise in the course of business in the normal way.
You're saying that the government can look at this and has the programme of work to refer to look at this. Are you satisfied that they are looking at this right across the public sector to assess the potential impact of any reclassification?
I think from the evidence that we have, and if you take the example going back to the Aberdeen West Road peripheral route again, it moved very quickly to look at the other projects that were structured in a similar way and, you know, from a prudent point of view, applied them in that way. So it'll be very aware of what's happening. It'll be looking at what the ONS's programme of work is and trying to anticipate and what the outcome of these would be. It's got such a, as we see in the report here, in the example that we do have, the evidence that we do have, it can have a very significant impact on capital plans and borrowing. So it's really important that they keep on top of that. It's maybe a question you'd like to ask the government itself about how it keeps an eye on that type of thing as well.
Can I just add to that very briefly, Convener? You mentioned in your question the question of college reclassification, and I think that's actually a slightly different case from the capital, the infrastructure projects we've been talking about this morning, and indeed housing associations. In the case of the colleges, the ONS decision came as a result of the government's reform programme on colleges. Again, I think the government was aware that there was a risk that it would have that effect, but it was felt that the increase in control and direction that the government would have counterbalanced that. The downside, if you like, of the decision from their perspective. So it's slightly different, but a very worthwhile question to explore.
Okay. Thank you very much. Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Vera. Auditor General, a fairly positive report, actually, on the whole. I think the one or two things that we've already been discussing are the key issues. Certainly the capital side is a wee bit of a concern. Was the government right in view of the ONS reclassifying the Aberdeen Western peripheral route, was the government right to voluntarily, if you like, reclassify those other projects?
I think, as Gordon was suggesting in his response earlier, there probably isn't a right or wrong answer to these. It is a question of judgment. It's a question of the balance of control in each individual case. The government felt it was the prudent approach to take, given that the other projects were structured in a very similar way to the Aberdeen Western peripheral route, and they felt it was worth taking that approach and taking the early budget hit that would involve in order to remove any doubt. But it may be a question you want to explore with colleagues from the government later on.
My understanding is that there has been some modifications to the NPD model. Will that result in them no longer being classified as as public sector projects?
My understanding is that the Scottish Futures Trust has been looking at the financing models that it's been developing and the one that was initially put in place for these projects to make sure that future projects can remain off balance sheet while still achieving the government's objectives. We don't yet know, because the ONS hasn't done its review, as Mark was highlighting earlier, what the impact of that will be on their decision. But there always is that trade-off, I think, between control and distance from government that needs to be managed. I think Mark would like to add to that.
Just a little bit of detail on that. There's another class of project, hubs projects, where the government redesigned the arrangements, and I think that might be what you're referring to. And by doing that, it was able to take the risk, lessen the risk of classification to the public sector in that particular set of projects. And in terms of standard NPD projects, if there is such a thing, of which the four set out in the report are in that class, the government's now got a range of other options in terms of how it funds capital projects with new borrowing powers. And one of the things where the government will be doing is looking at how it uses those range of options. And one of the things they might be able to talk to you a little about is where they've got to with that.
I was particularly interested because in my own constituency, the New Battle High School project, I think, has been done under the revised NPD model. So I don't know the extent of which Audit Scotland's really looked at that model.
So the things I can say about that one is I'm not entirely sure the status of New Battle, but I suspect that it'll be one of those hub projects and it'll be in relation to the new model around hub projects. Our role's not to assess whether that's the right or wrong model, it's the way in which that works. One of the points that we've made previously is that there needs to be a balance between control, for good reason sometimes, and direction, and the classification that results from that. And that's a judgment for government to take about what the trade-off between those two things are.
It might be helpful for the committee, if you've got the information, to understand what the new model is, how it's composed. I presume there's one model only at the moment that's in use as an alternative.
I think there is briefing material available that we can certainly bring to the committee.
I think that would be helpful. Obviously, this is, as you've already said, affected the capital budget, and you've, under paragraph 30, you've covered a few of the significant areas which the government has sought to cover that. I was interested particularly on bullet point 2, the reprofiling of loans to Scottish Water. What's the implications of that? I mean, I'd like to think that it says that when you say that the loans are being delayed, drawdowns have been delayed to the point where Scottish Water needs the cash funding. I would have hoped in good management they'd be doing that anyway. But what are the implications of that?
We'll be keeping an eye on the impact of it on Scottish Water and on the government's accounts during this year's audit work and in future years. I think in terms of why the government felt that was an appropriate decision to make to close the budget gap in 2015-16, it would be a good question to ask colleagues from the Scottish Government later on.
I'd like to know a little bit more about reprofiling of loans, because that implies a bit more than just managing more tightly when the drawdowns take place.
Absolutely. The relationship between the government and Scottish Water is a complex one and an important one, given the scale and importance of its capital investment programme, and it's one we're looking at quite closely. Mark may want to add something to the detail, but I think in terms of looking at the overall impact, it's something we would need to come back to you on in future years. The decision was taken in 15-16.
Just add a little detail, which is there's a multi-year commitment to funding for Scottish Water, and within that multi-year commitment there's a degree of discretion for the government about which years funding's provided in, and of course that links to how fast the work's going and when the need, when the requirement is from Scottish Water, and there's the ability for the government to consider what's the best judgment about when those funds are applied and conversation with Scottish Water. And one of the opportunities that they took in terms of closing the gap that we've explained that arose from the ONS classification was to think about the exact timing, which year some of that funding was in, and to make sure that married up to Scottish Water's needs.
The other one is bullet point 4, postponement of uncommitted grants and lower than forecast expenditure on demand-led capital funding schemes. What is the You've given some examples here of the portfolios, but the type of projects that are being affected by this, uncommitted grants, does that just mean grants that have not been drawn down?
More than not drawn down, actually have not been committed. People haven't applied and been approved for a grant in that case. So the money is still available for use, and in this case the decision was taken to reallocate it.
So the government didn't just put the money away from the project?
It reallocated it from a portfolio or policy area, but it wouldn't be people who already had a commitment that they were entitled to the grants and therefore able to spend it.
Okay, so nobody was actually deprived of money as such. There was no projects that were actually stopped because of it.
I can add just a small piece to that, which is my understanding is that some of these projects, it's about demand-led. So it's about lack of people coming forward to take up grants that are available. So an element of that is what the Auditor General says, alongside that demand-led element as well. So there's different aspects to it.
So would this be, what would this cover? I mean, does it cover housing or?
Yeah, part of it in this particular portfolio really? Will be housing and applications from people for affordable housing and the like. That type of thing is one element of that.
Was an element of it housing associations?
I don't know beyond that, other than there are schemes that the government has that if they do provide money, scores against their capital budget. There's an element of this, the capacity that they're able to generate to meet the ONS challenge was able to be absorbed by the fact that less people were coming forward for some elements of these grants that are available. But beyond that, in terms of the individual grants, I don't have any detail on that.
Okay.
Okay, Alec Neil.
Okay, thank you. Can I change tack a wee bit and ask you more about the revenue side than the expenditure side? Because obviously we're moving in, and this is really the first year of us moving into a situation where there are more significant tax-raising powers for the Parliament. And obviously that's going to, as you said, Auditor General, increase next year. I want to explore a wee bit the role of the Fiscal Commission. Because I know, and let me say right away, I fully understand the difficulties and the challenges of trying to accurately forecast government revenue for next month, never mind for the next year or the next 2 or 3 years. So I caveat and qualify my comments by saying that. But the forecast for LBTT and the landfill tax were underestimates by about 13%. So two questions, really. If you look at the OBR, which itself has not always got it right, to say the least, and other forecasting, you mentioned New Zealand, which I believe has got a very robust fiscal commission-type setup. Is 13% within the kind of acceptable parameters? Or would you expect, and as time goes on and the expertise increases, would you expect a more accurate level of forecasting, plus or minus? And secondly, if I were a spending minister, if I was still in the government and I was a spending minister, I would be asking myself the question in discussions about proposed cuts for the future, is this a way of the finance minister deliberately underestimating his revenue and swirling away the difference into this new reserve account for a rainy day? Or is this, you know, a genuine situation? Is the Fiscal Commission genuinely independent? What resources are available to it? Has it got an independent view of the Scottish economy, or does it just extrapolate the OBR forecast based on the UK Treasury model of the UK economy? I mean, it seems to me the Fiscal Commission is now going to play a fairly pivotal role in the management of the public finances of Scotland. And I'm trying to get an understanding of just all of that, including to what extent do you as the Auditor General actually examine the robustness of the Fiscal Commission's deliberations?
There's an awful lot in that question, Mr. Neil, and I'll do my best and ask colleagues to come in and make sure we've covered as much of it as we can. And I'm sure you'll understand there are some bits we probably can't cover in there as well. First of all, I agree wholeheartedly that this question of forecasting taxes will become central to the Scottish Government's budget in ways it simply hasn't been in the past. We're moving over a very short period of time from about 10% of the money that's spent in Scotland by the Scottish Government being raised in Scotland, mainly through council tax and non-domestic rates, through to when the Scotland Act 2016 powers are fully in place, about 52% from a range of different taxes, where both the tax forecast and the block grant adjustments will bring variability and volatility that will need to be managed. The forecast will be key to providing some stability to Scotland's public finances in doing that. And as Mark said earlier, in response to an earlier question, there's no such thing as a correct forecast. We know that from experience across the UK and globally, particularly, I think, in times of uncertainty like those we're living in at the moment. In relation to last year's tax forecasts, they were endorsed by the Scottish Fiscal Commission, and there's no doubt in my mind that in the first year of a new tax, there is complexity anyway. I think we're still uncovering areas where we don't have good enough data that's Scotland-specific to what's happened over a period of time and what may happen in future, and we saw an element of that in relation to the two devolved taxes last year. And we also saw the uncertainty or the behavioural effects produced by the way the taxes were announced, with a relatively early budget compared to the UK budget that allowed some forestalling, a move by the UK budget later and a response by the Scottish Government budget, all of which produced some changes to the assumptions that had been used by the government and endorsed by the Fiscal Commission in their original forecasts. Over time, that should improve. We will be developing better data. We'll need to have better data on things like VAT in Scotland as the Scotland Act 2016 comes in. The same, I'm sure, will be true on Scottish taxpayers for the rate of income tax. And there will still be behavioural effects and the effects of political decision-making that are hard to foresee at this point. You asked about the Finance Secretary's use of the budget reserve, the current budget exchange mechanism from next year, the budget reserve. The budget exchange mechanism at the moment, as Mark said earlier, does have constraints on its use. Funding which is put into it because of higher than expected revenues from the devolved taxes can only be used at the moment to make up shortfall in those devolved tax revenues in future years. There's a degree more flexibility from April next year when we move to the budget reserve, where instead of there being quite that limitation on how the funds are used, there's instead a cap on the total amount that can be carried forward. Mark may want to add to that, but I think the point I'd like to make is that that volatility needs to be managed, and there's a need for much more clarity and transparency about the way all of those streams interact to help you in Parliament make good decisions and scrutinise the government's performance and help people across Scotland to have their say on what matters to them about it. Mark, anything you want to add?
I think the area I'd add is just around your question around, I guess, the independence of the Fiscal Commission and how it's been set up and established and resourcing. And obviously an issue that's been subject to a great deal of consideration by the Finance Committee previously. I think we very much recognise the importance of that independence and unbiased forecasting. We think that that's been the way in which the Fiscal Commission is proposed to be established will give it the basis for how it operates in an independent manner, and we'd expect fully to operate fully independently and robustly in the forecasts that take place. I think the other element that's in here that's worth mentioning is increasingly there'll be opportunity for independent commentators, and we're beginning to see this already, comment on some of the forecasting that's going on. So as well as machinery within government, if you like, and how that works, there's an opportunity to benchmark some of that. It's not our role to second-guess forecasts. It's not our role to look at the detail of forecasting methodology. But as part of our continuing range of work, we'll look at how the governance of all these bodies works and how effectively they operate within the overall system.
Okay. I think it would be useful at some point, convener, for this committee to get a presentation from the Fiscal Commission, because it is going to be so important. I think maybe, you know, sometime in the new year might be the appropriate time, but I do think we should have a detailed understanding of all of the aspects of this. Can I just mine a wee bit deeper into the new reserve? is there any limitation as to how much can go into the reserve? You say obviously there's a limitation in how much can be carried forward for spend for the following year under the current arrangements, but what are the limitations on the reserve? What are the kind of basic rules around the reserve?
You're testing my knowledge of the detail, of course, and we'll be happy to provide the detail, but in a broad sense, there's a limit on how much can be put in and taken out in individual years, and there's a limit on how much can be held in total.
Can you tell us what those limits are?
So we'll come back with the detail of that.
Right.
I think from memory, the overall limit's 700 million, but government might be able to confirm that today, and we'll come back with the detail on that.
Right, okay. So what happens then, supposing there is an underestimate of the revenue, say to the tune of 13%, as there was last year, and you're already at 690 million. You know, how quickly do you know the under? Because tax, you're not sure until the end of the tax year, really, what your final tax take is. I mean, it's sometime after the end of the financial year before you know the final figure. So, you know, how does all that reconcile?
I'm going to help Mark out because his memory was very good, and we actually can complete the picture now for you, Mr. Neil. You might recall that we published at the beginning of this session of Parliament a short briefing paper on Scotland's new financial powers that aims to set out some of these questions. The limits on the use of the reserve are an annual limit of £350 million going into it,
right,
and an overall limit of £700 million, as Mark said.
Right.
You're right, in a theoretical situation where the reserve was butting up against that £700 million limit, there would be a limit to how much more could go in during that financial year. Mm-hmm. And that's why this ability to strategically manage the government's finances, to see the whole picture, to see what's happening with the revenue budget, with tax receipts coming in, with capital spend as well, is so important, that the government wouldn't want to end up in a position where it had an underspend of which a chunk could not be put into the reserve.
Exactly.
And that's why that big picture we think is so important.
Right. And can I ask you, I mean, as I understand it, there are now three elements in the new Scottish Reserve. There is excess, if I can put it that way, tax revenue beyond what had been forecast. Although I take it the Finance Minister's not obliged to put it into the reserve, they can use it for additional spend if they so wish. But let's, for the purposes of this, assume they put it into and play a very prudent game. So they put this excess revenue into the reserve, they put revenue underspend into the reserve, and they can put capital underspend into the reserve. Is that right?
So we'd need to confirm
those are the three elements.
Yeah.
Now, in terms of when you come to want to spend the reserve, if you put X amount for capital reserve in, can you only spend that amount on capital and simultaneously with revenue? Question number one. And question number two is the excess tax, if I can call it that for the purposes of this discussion, element of the reserve, can that be spent on either capital or revenue spend or not?
You're helping us very successfully demonstrate the complexity of this, and I'll ask Mark to answer the two specific questions you have.
I think that there's two parts to the answer. One is the detail of how it'll work in practice is still being worked out between Treasury and Scottish Government.
Right.
There is the principle, however, around all of that is that there is a range of new powers to give the government much more flexibility in how it manages the whole picture. The reserves one element of that, borrowing powers are another element of that, and how the two work together will be one of the big issues in the future. And the point that the Auditor General makes is about, in managing all that, there's a need for a kind of well thought through, principle based strategic approach to what the government wants to do in terms of managing its risk and complexity around all that as it goes forward.
Okay, so it's obviously a kind of changing goalpost type situation until we get the final detail, really, I suppose, isn't it?
Yeah, I think we're all in a situation where, as we go on, there's more decisions are made and more things become clear.
Yeah. One other question, which is not particularly related to that, and it's a very simple and straightforward question, does the 5% rule still apply, whereby no more than 5% of revenue could be used to support borrowing or PPP, PD, PDP type projects?
I think that's very much a question for government, because the 5% rule, in a sense, isn't a rule in the same way that the elements of the fiscal framework are. It was a commitment made by government that it would keep the revenue consequences of capital investment made through things like the non-profit distributing model to no more than 5% of the DEL budget. And as far as I know, it's not contained within the fiscal framework. Right. It may still be a prudent approach that the government wants to take to managing its budget longer term, but it's a question for government about what their position on that commitment now is.
It's not a statutory requirement, it's a Treasury understanding, basically.
I think it's straightforwardly a government commitment itself, a Scottish government commitment.
Right. Okay.
Yes.
Great, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Can I ask, first of all, about the underspend in education?
Yes.
It immediately struck me as quite large. There's been so much debate on education recently, and it had the largest departmental underspend of 196 million. Auditor General, you explained that it's due to technical accounting adjustment related to student loans. Does that account for the whole underspend?
I will ask one of my colleagues, Gordon, will give you the details on it, but you're right, the bulk of the underspend relates to the way in which the value of the student loans book is calculated each year, depending on the likely repayment levels from it. Gordon.
That's the short answer. Within that, there's about £82 million relates to that reassessment of the student loan book. Another complicated methodology which is used to value the total amount of student loans that are outstanding to the government. So that's a large element is of that. The accounts themselves have got more detail in terms of the portfolio differences in budget in the portfolio, but that's the bulk of that one. I don't have any other detail to hand.
Sorry, you say 82 million 82. Is can be accounted for by the student loan adjustment.
That's right.
So we're still talking about 110 million underspend.
Have you got the accounts?
We're doing a team job between us, convener. The accounts themselves break it down into more detail. Of the total, as Gordon has said, 82 million relates specifically to the loan book. The other significant figures in there are advanced learning and the Scottish Further Education and Higher Education Funding Council at 46 million and learning at 30 million. But you may want to explore with the witnesses who follow the detail of what comes into that. There are notes in the accounts as well, and Mark's going to pick that up for you as we do team tag here.
Thank you.
So one of the things that the accounts do in detail is significant variances are explained in the accounts. On pages 68 and 69 of the accounts sets out some of the detail of what the other reasons behind the education position are. And I'm sure the government will be able to talk you through some of that.
Okay, but you said 46 million is due to funding council underspend and 30 million on learning.
So the big ones I have in front of me today is 30 million underspend on learning, 13 underspend on children and families, 87 on higher education student support, which is the student loans issue that Gordon talked about, and 46 million on further and higher education funding council.
It's quite significant, is it not, in a department?
They're obviously very big numbers in absolute terms, and I think our starting point is that all government spending is intended to achieve positive outcomes for people of Scotland, so they're significant in that sense. On the other hand, in the context of a budget of some £34 billion, they are relatively small numbers, and I think it's important for us to keep that proportion in account there. It's one of the largest underspend areas in the budget, but each of the numbers themselves, I think, are relatively small. Okay. Worth exploring with colleagues in a moment.
Thank you. On Appendix 1, page 22, I know pension pots are very difficult to predict, but there's a 23 million underspend on teachers and NHS pension schemes. Do you know why that is? Or is it just, is that quite a regular occurrence?
I don't have the direct answer to that. Again, I think it's worth looking at the figure in the context of the overall spend across the NHS and teacher schemes, which are the big ones that are there. And the other thing to point out, of course, is that what we're looking at today is the consolidated accounts, which are separate to this and cover a whole range of work, but it's worth reflecting the fact that there are many underpinning sets of accounts, including separate accounts for each of these major pension funds. That may give more insight into that, but I think in my own view would be in the context of these numbers that are over £3 billion, £23 million is a relatively small amount, and particularly the type of area, as you say, that it is in pensions.
Okay. Can I ask about the previous audit committees have called on the Scottish Government to produce accounts that would cover the whole of the public sector. For the benefit, really, of us new members on the committee, Auditor General, could you explain really the practical benefits of producing whole public sector accounts?
Absolutely, Convener. I know that committee members are always looking for additions to your reading load, given your commitment
always
to the work here. I commend to you a report we published back in 2013, which is called Developing Financial Reporting in Scotland, which was our starting point for why this matters. In brief terms, though, I think that against the backdrop of the greater volatility, the greater opportunities and risks that the new financial powers bring to the budget of the Scottish Government and the Parliament's role in approving that budget and then scrutinising how it's been spent at the end of the year, we think there is room for bringing together the whole of the public sector into one place to give you that overall picture. And just one example of why that's so important, those financial statements would include a balance sheet, a statement of financial position that would go beyond what you have in front of you today to include the pensions liabilities of local government, all of the other public sector pension schemes, and give that overall picture of the liability and how it's changing over time. It would also give a picture of the total borrowing across the Scottish public sector with the Scottish Government's new borrowing powers, but also the borrowing that local government has been able to do over a number of years now, and give you that picture again of how that's changing and where the risks and opportunities might be, either potentially to invest more in Scotland's infrastructure or indeed to recognise that there might be risks in an environment where interest rates start to rise again after a long period of very low rates. Mm-hmm. That's just one example of why we think it's so important. It's bringing that whole picture together so that you, people across the Parliament and people across Scotland, have got in one place a single picture of what Scotland's public finances look like. Great. It's worth noting we do have whole of government accounts at a UK level, which includes Scottish information. We just don't have that national picture for Scotland itself, and I think it's time that we should have.
Okay, thank you very much. My colleagues have touched on this already this morning, but I wanted to ask a bit about performance reporting. What is your view on the Scottish Government's written submission, which sets out its plans to develop financial and performance reporting?
I very much welcome the commitments that are set out in the Permanent Secretary's letter. It feels to us, I think, that it covers the right areas. As always, it's often not until you start to see the prototypes and the examples of how it works in practice that you can see how far it will fulfil the needs of the Parliament and people with an interest more widely. Mm-hmm. We're committed to working closely with colleagues in government to give our views as they develop, but I think I'd have to reserve an opinion on how well they fulfil what I think is needed until we've got something that's slightly more worked up than the commitments that the letter includes.
From what they've set out, I mean, I've asked you before about the preventative agenda. Yeah. Do you think from what they've set out, they're likely to give us the information that we need to work out if that preventative agenda and spend on it is actually working?
I think it's very much a question of how it's done. Mm. The areas that are covered could well cover the areas that would enable you to get that picture. And as I described in response to an earlier question, in New Zealand, there is more information available about what prevention means in specific portfolio areas and even more in relation to specific groups of people and communities. And I think, as I say in my report, as I recommend in my report, it is that linkage between a commitment to improving an outcome and what particular strategies and plans are in place and the way money is following that, that I think has got room for more development in Scotland. What the Permanent Secretary sets out in her letter could achieve that, and I'd like to see more development in practice.
So we'll have to wait and see, really.
I'm afraid so. Yes.
Okay, thank you. My biggest concern in the report is paragraph 76, which indicates that there's a permanent loss of £14 million grant to the Scottish Government, which it cannot now recover. Can you make comment on that, please?
Yes, I think Gordon's best place to talk you through what's behind that figure of £14 million.
The report describes the process that has been happening in terms of suspensions and interruptions of the individual programmes. And in normal circumstances, if you like, over the period of these programmes that run for quite a while, this one, you know, over the period of 6 or 7 years, what would happen is if there are problems emerging in a particular programme, what's available to governments, and this applies across the whole of Europe, is that they can actually withhold some of the claim they're making, but recycle it, as we describe it here. In other words, say that they agree that there's been some problems here, we're going to put them right, and then over time use the money that's then available for other projects. The problem with this particular point this year is that we're coming to the end of that particular scheme that ended in 2013. They are complicated and they take quite a long time to, if you like, come to a final conclusion. And in fact, it's worth noting that the final accounting for the 2007-13 programme will not really happen until the spring of next year. At that point, a line is drawn right across the whole of the programme, and then we'll know the whole position. What the government's seen here in terms of looking at the what it had to do to get the suspensions lifted. In a practical sense, that means that the money can start flowing from Europe to Scotland in this case. They had to make that correction to the previous claims for eligible expenditure. That was accepted by Europe, the suspensions were lifted, and therefore the funds were able to start flowing again into Scotland. But because where we are in the programme, there's no opportunity to recycle, and therefore the accounting that's been done here is to reflect that likely permanent loss of grant.
The suspensions are because there are problems here in Scotland.
Yes, absolutely.
Why are there problems here in Scotland?
The suspensions and interruption process that the EC put in place is cutting through. It's really to protect the European money, to make sure that the money that Europe wants to spend in these projects is used for the purpose intended. And it's a sequence of events involving the Scottish Government right the way down through partners such as councils out into the individual projects in communities to do with infrastructure projects, and it might be to do with helping people into work and that type of thing. And where there are problems that emerge from that, for example, if audit trails are not kept of how money was spent, they're not as good as they should be, if some of the rules around things like procurement are not being followed, they then lead to what would be called through the audit process errors. And these errors are then looked at on a sample basis across the population, and then that leads to the European Commission, in this case, suspending the projects until things are put right. So it's a complicated process, but I hope that gives some sense of the key elements of it.
It does. You talked there about a whole chain of
yes.
places where an error could occur, from Scottish Government right down to sort of local authority grant funding. And do you have any sense of where, is there any pattern of where these errors are occurring? I'm just concerned. I mean, communities like mine in Dundee receive structural funds, and there'll be members representing communities around the country that potentially lost some of this money. Do we know where the errors are occurring?
The errors will be done through identified through audit, sampling of individual projects. And I don't have the detail of that. What's important, though, is the effect on the programme overall. And to use that phrase, ultimately the responsibility rests with the Scottish Government, as the, in the technical sense of the managing authority, as it's called, for the project. So it really has to deal with the responsibility, indeed the financial risks that come out if there are errors in the system.
You're absolutely right to ask the question, Convener. I think to summarise what we're saying here, and it is a complex picture, on the whole, the money will still have been spent for the benefit of communities. The problem is that the Scottish Government isn't able to recover that £14 million of the total budget that was available, and therefore that money isn't available for other purposes across the Scottish budget.
Yes. But this isn't new, is it? Because your report in 2010-11 said there was a loss of European funding to Scotland, and this arose because Scottish Government procedures at the time did not meet the standards required to ensure the use of funds complied fully with EU legislation. So that was 6 years ago. So are you saying there hasn't been an improvement since then?
I don't think we are saying that. There certainly was mention in the audit report in 2010, and you'll forgive me that I can't comment in more detail on it because I wasn't in Scotland at the time, but I certainly wasn't Auditor General at the time. I think what we're seeing in this instance, in the 15-16 report, is actually specific problems that were identified with the projects in place at that time through the audit process. As Gordon said earlier, the government has been working with the European Union to make sure that the controls in place for the next project from 2014 to 2020 are robust and will meet the European Union's requirements, but the failings have led to a loss of grant of £14 million in 15-16 for the previous programme up to 2013. Mm. So I wouldn't say there had been no improvement, but certainly problems were identified in 15-16 for the previous programme.
There's certainly not been sufficient improvement that we've managed to resolve this and to make sure that we receive all the money allocated to us by the EU. I mean, do you think there are long-term institutional weaknesses with the way the Scottish Government deals with EU funding?
I'll ask colleagues to come in a moment, if I may. I would say that I think your characterisation of this as being quite a long chain is an accurate one, and there are always risks in doing that, that the government is deliberately and intentionally passing European funding through, often to quite small community organisations, spending it on important community-based projects with people who aren't used to complying with significant audit requirements. That's not an excuse, but I think it is a reflection of that this isn't as straightforward as it might appear on the face of it. Gordon, do you want to add to that?
No, I think that really covers it. The important point here is about the government having the right management processes in place and making sure that these are enforced down through the system. It is a complicated, we described a complicated chain of events, but when there are problems in individual projects that manifest themselves back up through in terms of suspensions and interruptions, it ultimately stops with the government. The government has to deal with the financial consequences of that.
Is there a problem? I mean, don't want to go into too much detail on this about the CAP programme, but there's huge problems with the CAP implementation and delivery in the Scottish Government, and we're seeing this money disappearing through structural funds. I mean, does Scottish Government have a problem dealing with EU funding?
I'd say the two issues are quite separate ones.
Okay.
And what we're seeing here is a specific problem with controls at a local level that have led to the government being unable to recover that £14 million in grant.
Okay. Can I thank the panel very much indeed for your evidence this morning? I suspend the meeting for 2 minutes for a comfort break. Good morning. I now welcome to the meeting Leslie Evans, Permanent Secretary, Alison Stafford, Director General for Finance, Aileen Wright, Deputy Director for Finance, Nicola Richards, Director of People, and Annie, how do I pronounce it?
Moises.
Hello, Annie. Chief Information Officer from the Scottish Government. I welcome you all this morning. The Permanent Secretary will make an opening statement before I open up to questions.
I don't have very much to say, Convener, at all. Just that I think it's important that we recognise, and you will have heard some of this from your previous discussions, I'm sure, the very special moment that we're in at the moment in financial terms, in fiscal terms, and particularly in how we explain and account for our spend and our earn. The balance of funding and income for the Scottish Government will be changing consistently over the next few years from a tax base in 15-16 of around 12% to something nearer two-thirds of our income by the financial year 2019-20. So much of what we may want to concentrate on this morning is how we are preparing the Government for that kind of landscape, both institutionally and in terms of our practices, our reporting, and the information that we share with you, with Parliament, but also with the people of Scotland.
Okay. Thank you very much indeed. I'm going to now open to questions from members. Monica Lennon, would you like to kick off?
Convener, good morning, panel. We talked a lot in the earlier session with the Auditor General and her team about performance and having a sense of outcomes, and I think you've covered quite a lot of that in your statement and asked the Auditor General about that, but I wonder if you can give us an update. I think you talked about the new governance arrangements that were in place or went live from the beginning of October. It's only November,
indeed.
Except, but could you give us an update on that and how things are going?
Yes, I could maybe give you an update on those two elements, because although they're linked, they are distinct. Mm-hmm. So in performance terms, one of the things that we've been looking at is refreshing the National Performance Framework, which you will be familiar with the 16 outcomes, mm-hmm. to update it in the context of what else it is that the government is focusing on and its ambitions. So, for example, we've been looking at introducing new material around fair work, around biodiversity and the environment, and also about communities and the place of communities. So there's some very specific work on the National Performance Framework itself, but as importantly and particularly in this context, I asked Alison Stafford to take over last year and refreshed this year a board which is looking at performance and priorities for the whole of the Scottish Government and how the outcomes are explained, what the milestones are to us achieving those outcomes. She's been doing some work with each director in the Scottish Government that has a responsibility for a national performance outcome and looking at the lines of accountability, the budget, the specific projects and actions which are leading to progress, which is monitored, as you know, on the website Scotland Performs. There'll be more information as well in the draft budget about how each of our 16 outcome measures are being articulated and what is contributing to those, and Alison might like to say a little bit more about that. So there is a lot of work on the actual performance reporting and the way in which we measure long-term outcomes by the inputs and efforts that we're making day-to-day, week-to-week. I think there's another point which I'm sure has come up in your discussions, which is how we ensure that this sits alongside the accounts, which is a highly technical set of information, and makes those two as real as possible. We're taking some steps around that as well to ensure that we're explaining to the wider public, as well as to Parliament, how these two interact and what the cause and effect of this is. Again, Alison may like to say a little bit more about that. If you want me to talk about the government's side, I instigated, when I first became Permanent Secretary, a fresh look at our governance arrangements. There are a couple of reasons why I did that. One of those is it's good practice, and indeed the Cabinet Office down south recommend about every 5 years or so, which is roughly the same as the period of time since we last looked at our governance arrangements. I think the other reason was I'm acutely aware of the future for the Scottish Government and the challenges and opportunities that are presented by new powers, tax being some of them, but by no means those, mm-hmm. but also a whole range of other external contexts and factors, some of which we've been listening to and experiencing over very recent weeks and even recent days. So governments can't stand still. We need to ensure that the governance arrangements that we have operate with due transparency and aid clear decision-making, make that effective and make sure that we're clear about performance and clarity of direction. And I can say a little bit more about the changes I've introduced if you'd wish me to.
Thank you. Yeah, I think I'm a bit interested to get an understanding of the sort of different options that are available to government in terms of indicators and milestones. I touched on this with the Auditor General because there's a sense that there's perhaps a lack of indicators, but just as importantly about quantity, it's also about having the right indicators. Mm-hmm. And I just wondered, I'm sure there's a whole menu of different options that are available, but you know, what are some of those options and which ones are maybe sort of preferable?
I mean, the National Performance Framework, as you know, is now enshrined in law. Mm-hmm. And I mean, Scotland is in a very special position being a leader in this area. We are the first government to introduce a wholly outcomes-focused approach, and others are following us. In fact, I was in Northern Ireland just last week, and they are just developing their outcomes approach based very much on our model, drawing on our model. But interestingly, they are looking slightly differently at how they use indicators and measures to show people where those long-term outcomes, because they are usually long-term, how we are moving along, mm-hmm. and what is helping us to move along that route. So what we're looking at the moment is the accountabilities in particular areas. In justice, for example, we've done some great work where the justice strategy lays out very clearly what the specific strands of work will be that will contribute to the outcomes that have a justice implication, or indeed contribute to other outcomes which you wouldn't call justice but are still important. Mm-hmm. So children having happy and healthy lives, there is a justice element to that. Mm-hmm. That model works very well, and we're encouraging other parts of the organisation, and Alison is working with directors at the moment to see whether that model or another might enable us to have a consistent approach to share that information at the right times during the year, and indeed as part of the draft budget. And the information you'll see in the draft budget in a few weeks' time will give you an increased element on all of those 16 outcomes. But Alison, I don't know if you want to talk about that.
Yes, certainly. So last year, and there's a model here, and obviously we can make sure if the committee want to see this, there was actually a material that was provided alongside the draft budget last year that not only provided a trail of indicators, the trend material that's really important, but also some explanation of where you can see the connection between the outcomes that are set out in the National Performance Framework and the actual activities that are taking place and how that links to the budgets. Now, obviously, money isn't the only thing that a government can do to ensure an outcome is delivered. And there's a whole broad range of things that even if we looked at environmental issues, we would know there would be societal issues, public attitudes, changes in technology. So I think there's something about actually being able to see these various contributing factors. Clearly, the National Performance Framework is our absolute benchmark around these areas. That was designed actually building on best practice that was available at the time when it was established roughly nine years ago. It'll be its 10th anniversary next year. And obviously what the Community Empowerment Act last year said, mm-hmm. that it actually would be four administrations of the day every 5 years to really be doing a refresh. So over the next few weeks, there will actually be the start of a dialogue and consultation process that will actually be then taking a good hard look to make sure that actually these indicators are fit for purpose for the future. I think that's really important given our different span of responsibilities that the Parliament will have as well as the government going forward. We'll be using Carnegie UK and Oxfam Scotland actually to be able to engage with people across Scotland as well as the sort of usual suspects of those that will have an academic view or a technical view around these things, actually to make sure that we reach out in that way. One of my observations is working with directors on this and particularly looking at the justice model that the Permanent Secretary has already mentioned, is that actually there can be a huge gap between the overarching outcomes and some of the indicators and the real connectivity into what it is that people have to do differently to see the outcomes we want to see. And I think the work in justice has shown actually about building a community of interest, actually that whole system approach has been one of the major areas. And actually I'm really pleased to say that there are other directors that are now actually seeing that as a method. You know, how we do these things is important as what we state as the outcomes we want to do. So there's particular work around environment, climate change and land reform. That particular portfolio has actually produced a draft portfolio-wide basket of outcomes and priorities and are working with their communities to actually make sure that that line of sight can be seen there and to see how those changes are really going to make a difference in the things we want to see. Also, the National Improvement Framework in relation to education, that has been aligned to the National Performance Framework. Now, a number of these things obviously have been post the election in May and seeing the programme for government published on the 3rd of September. These are actually providing methods and ways of actually making sure that the ambitions that have been set out, equally alongside the outcomes, there's a line of sight to see how those are being developed. Just to say a little bit more about what will come in the draft budget. So we have a publication date for that of the 15th of December. The material that you will have seen from last year will go on a stage further. And it will actually be pulling in the roles and activities of public bodies, because this was obviously designed around what was in the scope of the things within the Scottish Government. But as I've just said, we all know that things are delivered actually through arm's length bodies, community groups and a whole range of contributors to make a difference in Scotland. So that's what you will see will be a further development of this as we go forward for the draft budget in December. I hope that sort of answers some of the areas that you've been
It's very helpful, thank you. I wonder, I know that your team, you've been working very hard on it. I see again in your letter that the Scottish Government directors had been meeting over the summer. There's obviously been a lot of discussion and thinking. I just wonder, during those discussions, does there come a point where directors and senior managers are able to point to policies and initiatives that perhaps are not working as well as they should be, or not as effective in contributing to outcomes as ministers might expect, or indeed the public might expect? Because, you know, I'm quite new to this committee, and we've looked at a number of reports from Audit Scotland, but sometimes it is very difficult to know where the sort of weak points are, or sometimes we know, but it doesn't really appear like the policy is revisited. So I just wonder, from those discussions, in recent months, is there anything that's jumping out that maybe needs to be looked at again?
I think if I can mention in general terms, the responsibilities of directors and those that work with them and support them, particularly analysts and statisticians, their role is to ensure that we are continuing to pursue evidence-based policy. That's a very important part. So policies shouldn't be coming into being without a clear understanding of what their impact is likely to be, and the evidence that shows the timing and the impact over a period, you know, a period of months or a period of years, depending on the ambition of the policy. I think the other thing to be borne in mind is we often end up testing out policies. I mean, pilot is a word that is used very frequently within the public sector. And those tests are usually with very good reason, i.e. we think we have evidence as to why this is going to work. And the evidence may tell you it is. How it is implemented, how people respond to it, and how it interacts with what I call the real world, does not always follow through. So we have to constantly scan and see whether a policy's evidence is showing rationally that is working, but actually the implementation, the behaviours that it's producing, or in unintended consequences. That will always be a dial that directors and the policy colleagues that they're working with will be attending to and looking at. So nothing is set in stone, and it is part of good policy making to ensure that decisions and the impact of policies at arm's length in the real world are constantly being monitored and checked to see if those work or not.
Well, I appreciate that sort of general picture, but are there any examples through all that sort of monitoring and evaluation of policies perhaps that are not working as effectively as they should be, or is everything brilliant?
I will endeavour to come back to you with some examples. I can't think of anything at the moment. I can think of examples from my own time in policy making, so on, where shifts have been made, where emphases have been changed. And I can think actually of an example which perhaps might illustrate the justice position. Years ago, the intention, and this was even around the time when the first outcomes, you know, when outcomes were in their making their baby steps, we would have a group of people who were working all part of the system, justice system, and doing, you know, their best to make the justice system work. The issue about the justice system was the interaction between the cause and effect, between the justice system. And that was the issue which we needed to address and make sure that we were pursuing in the leadership of those organisations, in the way those people worked together, and in the fact that they saw themselves as part of a whole system. So although that isn't a policy per se, it's quite an important element of how we introduce change to achieve outcomes. That is, to get people round a table, both metaphorically and in reality, to say, if I do this in my part of the system, what's it going to make, what difference is it going to make to your part of the system and the public that we're all serving? But I will come back to you with a bit more time to think and give you an example or two.
I would appreciate that. Again, I'm mindful that some of the points that have been raised by the Auditor General in her report have been accepted and have been addressed in your letter to the committee, but I'm aware that it was highlighted in the Auditor General's report last year that there was still scope for the government to develop and improve on its annual reporting. You did say in your opening remarks that, you know, with more powers coming to the Scottish Parliament, there is that issue around readiness. So I think given that there's been some points of improvement already made and we're still working towards that, and we have the additional powers coming to the Parliament, I wonder if you can give us an update on how well the government is prepared at this moment and where we need to get to.
Sure. I'll ask Alison to come in on this, but I suppose the main issue from our point of view is the institutional landscape and readiness that we've already put in place. So the Fiscal Commission, which you'll be aware of, and some of the other work that we're doing on ensuring that our budget reporting is as timely and as fulsome as it needs to be. On finance reporting per se, some of the activity that Alison was referring to earlier on has enhanced and will continue to develop what we share, the detail of what we share, and to make connections between new parts of our responsibilities. So, for example, Revenue Scotland will be producing a report on the taxes that it has gathered over the past year, and we will be making cross-references to that so that we're not seeing that in isolation from other parts of the finance estate, if you like. I think the other thing that's important here is for us to ensure that the accounts will always be, we can make them more streamlined, we can make them more accessible, we can make them more simpler. There will always be a highly technical document. Accounts are, I mean, you will know this better than I. And I think the important thing from our point of view is to ensure that we do what we can to make them accessible and simple, but we also ensure that the surrounding suite of documentation or references connects in to those accounts to make those a more transparent and an easier to navigate process. So some of the information that Alison was referring to earlier on that will accompany the draft budget and will come out before the end of the financial year should give some hot facts and figures, if you like, and some clarity, which is perhaps easier to navigate and a bit less technical in the nature of accounts, which will always have a particular, they have some constraints and some compliance issues, which will never make them the best bedtime reading. But it is going to be more important that we are facing outwards and that we are accountable to the public on the kinds of facts and figures that they need to know.
Thank you.
Thank you. Alison Harris.
Yes, thank you. I think I'm just really taking Monica Lennon's point a slightly further. You know, transparency is absolutely vital going forward. So what really has been done to, you know, strengthen transparency and indeed, you know, sustain it going forward? You know, could you give me some examples, please?
Well, I suppose the first one is obviously the role of the Fiscal Commission, which will be the is the responsible body for scrutinising and considering our intentions and the targets that we're setting for creating income through taxation. So they are another part of the institutional landscape that gives at arm's length and, in fact, independent from the Scottish Government, an assessment of how our tax raising, in that circumstance, our tax raising powers are being executed and whether or not we're fulfilling those. There will be, as I mentioned earlier on, additional material going out to the public, which will be showing in a more transparent and obvious way what it is that we're doing, how we're doing, and what those facts and figures tell us. And indeed, as part of the draft budget, there will be additional information, as I mentioned earlier on, about the performance framework. So all of those things will be giving people the opportunity to understand and see the connectivity and the new elements of the financial responsibilities that the government has now taken on. I don't know if you want to add to that, Alison.
Certainly. So, as the Permanent Secretary has said, there's actually a broad church of individual organisations now that are actually part of the architecture that supports the greater fiscal responsibility that Scotland has right now. So, obviously, what we have done is, and I think it's really important to point out, that there is actually a Scottish Consolidated Fund. That is the place where there is an account of all the income that is raised that comes to Scotland to then be dispersed. So we have actually set out in that a greater exposition of where the different income sources come that actually ultimately then sit behind the Scottish budget at the end of the day. And in that respect, there are then a number of players that are equally producing financial information. So we've mentioned Revenue Scotland. We already also know that our tax in this current financial year involves the Scottish rate of income tax. That will actually bring into that mix reporting from HMRC, because the collection and administration of that tax is actually by HMRC. So they have already set out in their accounts that they published certain elements that were referring to the business that they are now preparing for carrying out that administration and collection of tax in Scotland. And we expect then that they will produce an extract as well, because actually that will become one of the more material figures. In our current budget this year, the figure for income tax that's raised in Scotland is estimated at 4.9 billion. And for next year, because of the changes under the Scotland Act 2016, that will be a much more material figure. So it's really important, I think, we continue to bring into scope the transparency that we not only will be honouring ourselves, because that's important, we've actually made a pledge around open government, so that is in with the bricks, that is part of how we will be continuing to do business. But equally, we will want to see that sort of transparency from those other partners that are actually now part of our fiscal responsibility landscape. The things specifically that you can see that will be different over the next period, before we actually publish the draft budget that I've mentioned, that's on the 15th of December, we will actually put out a short guide that actually is more for the general public, and also as far as that would be helpful to Parliament as a whole, to actually understand what this changing landscape is, because it's going to feel very, very different to us. And actually the importance that places on us actually having sustainable economic growth is part of that. And we'll need to link in heavily to the strategy that was published earlier this year about sustainable growth. It's actually inclusive growth here in Scotland. By the 31st of December, we will actually set out a statement for the outturn report for the whole of the Scottish administration for the last financial year. At that point, all the accounts that actually utilise some of the Scottish budget that comes to us will all have been set out in the public domain, and we will distill that together and be able to produce that so that Parliament can see that. In January, we'll publish then a snapshot of the 2016 position that will start to bring the information in a more accessible format that is in our accounts, is in all of these other bodies' accounts, but start to pull it together so that actually you can see what's been changing on the assets, the investments we've been making in Scotland, what are the things that are changing around the liabilities. These, again, was within the boundaries of the Scottish administration. It will not bring local government in at that point. But it will be certainly covering all the other areas within the budget. Okay. So that will be in January. And then obviously I can say a little bit more about what our further steps are.
I'll bring you in for your next question. Can I ask members and the panel to keep their answers a bit questions and answers a bit shorter and sharper because I want to get through all members' questions, if that's OK. Alison?
Yeah, just to go back to what you said, we're going to let the public know. Is that in some form of brochure produced that will be posted out to everyone? Did I understand that correctly? Is that what you meant?
It will be an accessible guide. I wasn't expecting necessarily to post it out to everyone because of the overhead costs of that. But a guide that will be there for Parliament, and it's something that we will put on our website. So that actually there is material there that people can start to use, but I wasn't intending
The only way they'll use it is if they actually know to go and look it up. I'm just getting at this because I think it's very important that actually people appreciate the huge change that's coming to Scotland.
Yes.
And I misunderstood you. I thought they were going to actually be given some further information. It's going to be up to us to...
Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt. I think the intention is that it will be done online.
Right.
But I think the signposting for that,
right.
which the Parliament is a huge element,
yes,
of course,
absolutely.
But there are other things that we can do to ensure that people are aware that that's where you go
right.
to find out information.
That's just what I wanted to clarify. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Liam Kerr.
So there was a significant underspend on the budget last year, which I understand an element of which can be carried forward or spent by the government. So what analysis is done as to what that extra, or what the underspend is going to be? When does that analysis happen, such that how soon does the government know how much it's going to have in its pot that it hadn't anticipated?
So, as you would expect, we're tracking, or Alison and her team are tracking the spend the whole time throughout the year. In fact, we have monthly reports to the executive board, which has been introduced as part of our governance changes I was referring to earlier on. So there's a constant monitoring about spend. A lot of spend goes out, as you might expect, at the very beginning of the financial year, and then there is a whole range of policy-driven reasons why we might be delaying or spreading spend across the year. We have a very significant milestone around October when all directors are given a thorough support in checking that their spend is where we think it will be. And not all spend, of course, is profiled equally across the year, as I mentioned earlier on. But we have an in-year now, which we've introduced, an in-year check, that the forecasts which individual directors and their teams are making about spend are accurate. We cannot afford people to be thinking, I might or I might not spend this at a time of such constraint. So we've introduced a very robust but supportive and challenging process to allow people to say, actually, I think this might be different. I think we might be spending a bit more or a bit less. We have many of our bigger budgets are demand-led. And you will know from some of the work on pensions that, for example, some of those pensions actually align in one part of the budget rather than the AMI, and that is real cash going out. So we're having to constantly be anticipating what that demand might be about. That's not just about what we choose to spend, it's what we might have to accommodate. So there's a constant scanning process, and using that, Alison will be forecasting and giving ministers and myself as principal accountable officer a forecast of what we think the outturn is likely to be, and it is a bit like landing a helicopter on a postage stamp. It is an art, and I have to say the fact that we're now, in terms of the Her Majesty's Treasury budget figure, which we measure our underspending on, at 0.5% is pretty good, and it's better than last year, which is 0.7%. But Alison might like to say something about what happens nearer the time at the end of the year when we understand that we have an underspend and what we're doing with things like the transfer over into following years so we don't lose any of that underspend.
Mm-hmm. So, yes, that tracking is a dynamic process. It obviously needs to take cognizance of what's happening across the whole of the landscape. The important thing to note is that our makeup here for the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government control regime is that we have to live within the budget. We cannot overspend it. So just to be really clear, there will always be a level of underspend, and obviously these numbers, whilst they in absolute terms do sound large, relative to the whole budget, we're working within extremely tight margins. And because we cannot overspend, then obviously there is an element of just making sure that we do get just the right side of the line. The sorts of things that contribute to that dynamic environment is areas where the budgets are relying on people actually demanding or coming. We use the phrase demand-led, but that actually that people do take up, or the case is made for people to utilise particular budgets. We try and keep the budgets each year as taut and realistic to what we expect the demands to be. So we do track that really carefully. We have very tight margins, again, under each element of budget to work within from the point of view of being able to carry forward funds from one year to the next. I can absolutely assure you it has been every Cabinet Secretary for Finance's passion and equally the DG for Finance's passion to make sure that there is no money whatsoever that's lost to Scotland. So that is part of the tracking and the decision making. But we do have to work, and I'll give you the percentages for this year, we have to work within 0.6% of our RDEL budget, our resource budget. And if there's anything more than that, then we wouldn't be able to carry it forward and it would be lost, but we won't be in that position. The limit on our capital is 1.5%. And on the financial transactions, it's slightly larger, but it's larger on a much smaller number. So those are the levels of fine-tuning that we have to work to. And within those margins, we are allowed to carry forward to the next year.
Does that explain is that an answer to your question, Liam? Sorry, I'm just...
Yes, I'll move on.
Okay.
So, thanks for that answer. I'll move on to a slightly different area on land and buildings transaction tax being significantly lower. The revenues from that have been significantly lower than forecast. I think 13% was mentioned earlier on. What analysis is being done on those figures and the impact of the tax on house sales? What analysis has been done on future revenues and projections, and at what point will a decision be taken on whether the end game of the tax has been achieved?
Well, I'll ask Alison to talk a little bit more about the technical element of this, but there will be, and there is analysis. The first year, as you know, of any tax can be quite volatile, depending on what the tax is. Behaviours and the way people respond to that, and we had some slightly different interventions just as we were bringing the tax into being, as you know, from the UK government. We will be analysing, we are analysing, Revenue Scotland and our housing policy colleagues will be analysing what the information is that we can discern from the first year of the tax, and that will continue to inform policy and our future intentions, and indeed it will be information that the Scottish Fiscal Commission will be using as well as part of their test of the reasonableness of future forecasts.
Can I say, panel, can you please keep your answers as tight as possible, because we are really running short of time this morning.
We could leave it there if you like.
Thank you.
There's just one thing, just to be really clear. Last year's tax receipts actually exceeded the forecast. So there was a net positive receipt to Scotland of £74 million, just to be clear on that point.
You happy, Liam? Okay. Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Peter. Secretary, you mentioned both in your letter to the committee and also in the Audit Scotland report, it's mentioned about the new governance arrangements that they went live in October. So presumably they've been in place since the beginning of October. Can you give us some feel as to what those changes in governance comprised of? What actually has been put in place?
Okay, so we've changed the structure of the accountabilities within government about who reports to whom or what reports to what, more likely, which is the board structure that we had previously. We've most importantly deepened and strengthened the knowledge base of our non-executives to be able to enable them to challenge us and to bring in an independent and different perspective into the way we take decisions and the way we run our business within the Scottish Government. So although we're actually reducing down the number of non-execs, we're strengthening their role, and they are twinned. There will be two non-execs with each Director General. So Alison will have two, each Director General will have two, so that the knowledge of the business, if you like, is strengthened in our non-execs. I was particularly keen to increase the challenge function within the organisation, so we really get the benefit of those people who are there to act as critical friends. There are changes to the structures of the boards as well, and I can let you have a little map of that, which we've been using, and also about how we manage risk. So we have changed some of our risk processes too. But that's the that's a quick overview, a quick snapshot in mind of convener's question to be.
But as the Auditor General pointed out, an essential part of that is really a cultural and behavioural change.
Absolutely.
As well.
It is.
How is that being managed?
We've been engaging with staff because actually how they support these boards will be really important. We engaged with the non-execs from a very early stage when we were introducing the changes and asked them to give us a view of how our behaviours were working would help or act as a drag or a push on these changes. We've actually done quite a lot of work on the behaviour culture as a whole in the organisation under a change programme which I introduced when I came in as permanent secretary last summer, which is called SG 2020, which is very much about the organisation we need and want to be by 2020. But we will also have to test whether this is working or not. So we have a six-month review, which I have in place, and we're asking the Director General, who is the Crown agent, who is not involved in this process, to come in with a couple of colleagues and test whether or not the changes that we've set ourselves and the tests we've set ourselves have been achieved. But much of it will be to do with whether we behave differently within it. More frank, more open conversations. And we're getting feedback on that at each of our meetings, which makes for a rich seam of information.
Just to quickly move on to a slightly different thing, we've been talking with the previous panel about the ONS reclassifications and the consequences arising from that. One of the consequences in the Auditor General's report in paragraph 30 is the reprofiling of loans for Scottish Water. And I wanted to understand what the consequences of that were. When you're talking about reprofiling, you're not simply talking about, as the Auditor General said here, about delaying drawdowns of loans. There must be a fundamental change in the structure.
Yes, I'll ask Alison to speak about that, if I may.
So within a particular period for Scottish Water, and obviously that has an interface equally with the Water Industry Commissioner, there's an investment programme that's determined, and on the basis of that there is a loan profile that's set out over that period. What happened in 2015-16 is that we worked with Scottish Water to understand how they were delivering on that programme overall, and also the mix between actually how they were going to support that investment, the extent to which they actually had cash to utilise, and the extent to which they continued to need all of the loan that was penciled in for them for that particular year. What we were been able to do is actually see no diminution at all in the delivery of infrastructure investment that Scottish Water needed to take place in that year, and we were able to change the mix of the extent to which they used their own cash and the extent to which they used loans from government. The full loan contribution from government over the period will be there and will be honoured, and we were able to actually just do this, which made best use of public money at that time to be able to continue to do what Scottish Water needed to do for their programme and to make sure that those key investments that were under the NPD programme, the Aberdeen Western Periphery Route and the various others ones within the NHS, actually could go ahead.
Clearly the impact of the reclassification was unwelcome in terms of the budget. Are we satisfied now that we understand the implications of the ONS reclassification, that is reflected throughout the government's budget, and that we have a full understanding of what the going forward, what the ONS require?
So in terms of those MPD projects at the time where there had been a change at short notice in terms of the rules that were being applied, there had been a change from ESA 95 to ESA 10. So in terms of understanding the implications of that, those have all been taken into account, both in the financial year that we're looking at with the accounts and also for the subsequent budget, both for this year and also for 2017-18. That's the trajectory of those major projects that were under that scheme, of their life, where it will actually have a budgetary implication. So that has been assessed and it has been taken into account and has been managed as part of the whole capital programme. Certainly in relation to the other aspects, and this was all part of £3.5 billion that was actually put into this new arrangement for actually being able to bring additional capital investment into Scotland. We had to do that because in 2010, the main capital budget for Scotland was cut by over a third. And that was a response to what had been happening with the financial markets around 2008-09. There was obviously commitments that had been made to communities across Scotland to expect these investments to take place. So the MPD programme was set up to be able to deliver that. a lot of that delivery had already taken place, and therefore, you know, we needed to find a way of accommodating these things. But your specific question about have we now taken that into account, so in relation to these schemes, yes, we have. The contractual arrangements for the hub have changed so that those remain as a private classification, and therefore we are still getting additionality from that. And the other things that I initiated was actually to make sure that there was a more direct line of sight to the Office of National Statistics. Up till then, it had been the preserve just of Treasury to manage that relationship. And I insisted that actually we needed to have a line of sight and have a regular dialogue. So that happens. We have a structured arrangement that happens on a programmed basis for us to engage with the ONS, both to get a forward look on what they are anticipating in their programme. They actually now publish their programme on a periodic basis as to what will be there, and we are able to work with that. We do that in concert with the Scottish Futures Trust as well, and we also have built through all these processes the appropriate relationships into Eurostat as well. So that gives us the best possible intelligence, not only of when changes are coming, but actually what this has shown is actually about the interpretation and the interpretation that these various statistical bodies can place on what are pretty dry rule books that come out in relation to these things.
Alec Neil.
Just a few fairly quick factual questions to ask. The first one is obviously a bone of contention for some time now is the fact that Police Scotland, and I think from memory the Fire Service in Scotland, unlike their equivalent services in the rest of the UK, are charged VAT. In terms of last year, how much did that cost the Scottish Government?
I don't know if I have the exact figure. Alison may have it. I do know, because I was involved in it when I was Director General for Justice and Learning, that we had constant contact through finance and ourselves.
So, I mean, I'm happy to advise the committee of the precise figure, just as an order of magnitude. It was around maybe just under 30 million, but we'll get the precise figure for you.
So very significant figure, yes. Indeed. Okay. Which, are we still fighting the case, or have we given up in fighting HMRC and the UK government on this?
We continue, and particularly every time that there has been a sort of change of personnel within the Treasury to do that. So
I bring it up regularly with my counterpart at various opportunities.
And obviously with the signed VAT revenues, it makes even less sense than it did before, presumably. Mm. Okay, the second very quick question I have is, does the 5% rule still being applied so that no more than 5% of revenue is used to support capital repayments?
So, yes, there is still that necessary and prudent regime to ensure that the exposure in any one year of the government, compared with its budget, for those revenue-financed investments is in place. That's something that we have published since September 2013, and again, the latest update will be in the draft budget on the 15th of December.
And given the importance of capital investment, and given the previous discussion, would it still be prudent to increase that to 6%, say?
There's no plans at this stage to revisit that.
No, that's not the question I asked. The question is, would it still be prudent? What would be the impact? Wouldn't be disastrous to increase that to 6%, would it?
I think we would have to assess what was appropriate, given we will have a very changing risk landscape as we go forward. You know, at the moment, apart from in the terms of the year that we were looking at, 2015-16, around 12% has come from income elsewhere, and the rest has come through block grant. That comes in as we need to draw it down on a very predictable and measured basis. We have to predict a month in advance how much cash we're going to need each day. And we refine that as we get to that point. That's a very structured way. As soon as any administration moves to having a more mixed economy of the receipts coming in from different tax sources in different schedules and also the sorts of decisions that will mean we will need to take in that, we will move into a very different financial risk landscape. So I wouldn't necessarily be advising on changing the risk parameter around that with that kind of context.
Okay, thank you.
Why is there 192 million underspend in education?
I think the majority of that is to do with student loans. I will confirm that with my colleagues, but I know there will be some other small pockets of very small in context of the overall budget, which will probably be to do with money which has not been drawn down or which project has been delayed, so it's not lost to the education budget. But I don't know if colleagues want to say something more about the split between the loan and the portfolio spend.
Yes, so the most material element within the underspend is an 82 million. This is on page 69 of the accounts, and equally on 68, there's commentary on the same portfolio as well. That relates to lower than anticipated write-down of a particular element of the student loan book. That is a valuation change. And that money, the most important thing is that money cannot be used for anything else. So that could not be redirected to any other aspects of educational.
That spend. 82 million?
That's right.
Yes. How about the 46 million underspend for the Funding Council?
So that was actually to do with a release of cash reserves. The large element of that was £50 million. So that actually was actually utilising that in a way that that would be actually be better used across the whole portfolio.
Sorry, can you explain to me what that means?
So it was actually historical timing differences that had taken place between how the Funding Council was funded on a particular financial year and how that sits with a particular academic year. And that had actually generated a level of cash reserve that actually then wasn't going to be able to be used in any other way. So that actually was more appropriate for it to be released at that particular time.
Okay, so that £46 million is still sitting there to be used?
No, it has been released so that it could be used across the whole area. So that's all part of taking into account balancing one thing with another.
Across what whole area? Sorry.
So the whole area of the Scottish budget.
Right. So it's lost to higher and further education?
No, because higher and further education have actually all had their grants allocated over the academic years that they've been required.
Okay. Forgive me, I don't completely follow. So this £46 million has been underspent from education and has been reallocated right across the Scottish budget, but they've not actually lost it.
So in terms of the allocations from the Funding Council to the various sectors that require it in any academic year, then what has been committed to those areas have actually been fulfilled. So this is actually a technical area where that a particular body had actually accumulated cash that it couldn't actually use because it actually had allocated the budget that was actually available to it. So it is a technical point. It's probably something that's better for me to write to the committee about, and I'm very happy to do that.
That would be useful. That would be useful. How about the £30 million underspend in learning?
So again, this is an area where there is an element here that's related to demand led. So as you can see from the explanation actually in the account, there was slower than anticipated requirement by local authorities for free school meals.
I'm not hearing you very well. There were slower than anticipated what?
Demand that right. Came forward from local authorities for free school meals.
Okay.
They took up the opportunity to get funding rather slower than we might have anticipated. Some were more ready than others. Okay. So that demand will still be there. It's just that it wasn't enclosed entirely in that financial year. Okay. So we can't stop that demand. We still have to be able to fulfil it. It's just that the profiling of the spend, which we had thought would have taken place within a whole financial year, has not in the case of that policy.
The initial tranche of funding for the attainment fund, does that come under the learning budget?
So yes.
Yes, it does, is the short answer. Okay. Yes, because attainment would come from learning portfolio.
Okay, so is there any underspend on the attainment budget? So what I'm asking is, can any of that 30 million underspend be attributed to underspend on the attainment fund?
I think we'd need to go through it absolutely clearly, but the attainment fund is separate from that. These are not part of the attainment fund that has been recently set up, is my understanding. These are in addition to that. So I would need to confirm that so I'm not giving you the wrong information.
Oh, sorry, I thought you just said the attainment fund comes under the learning.
Sorry, the attainment fund comes under the portfolio of learning. So
right.
It is part of the responsibility that the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Learning would have responsibility for, and therefore overall the overall budget. The attainment fund is a specific part of that, And the threads which you see in children and families are from one directorate, which is in that portfolio that gives particular support to very early years, including, as you can see there, issues to do with school, with free school meals and to do with kinship care. Mm-hmm. So if you're talking about the attainment fund specifically, as opposed to attainment across the portfolio, that is a discrete fund.
So that's not accounted for in this budget? So where would the attainment fund, the separate attainment fund,
appear? It would be in education and lifelong learning, but it's
right.
Not in the underspend, which, to my knowledge, that have been identified in higher education in the funding council or in children and families. Perhaps it's easiest if we write to you and confirm and clarify that, so it's quite clear what we're talking about when we're talking about a portfolio, when we're talking about a fund, and what we're talking about underspent in specific parts of that portfolio.
That would be useful, because, yeah, I don't know if colleagues agree with me. I don't think any of us are clear on that. I mean, my question really yes. is, for reference to what you're going to write
yes.
to us about, is where does the attainment fund fall right. under all of these headings? Is it split across these headings? And how do we get to the point where we know if there has been
yeah.
an underspend on the attainment fund
per se?
If you could write to us as soon
yes.
as possible.
And the attainment
on
fund is new, of course, so it wouldn't necessarily feature within this set, but happily do that.
I kind of felt that the first tranche of money might feature in this, but if you could clarify that for us as well. So the 13 million underspend on children and families, you're not sure if that does include attainment fund money or not?
I just want to be absolutely clear in technical terms that I'm not giving you the wrong information. It may well
sure.
be that some of those threads are included in some elements of how the attainment fund was set up, so I just don't want to give you the wrong information. I think it's much better if we give you the accurate detail in writing.
Sure. I mean, overall, excluding the 82 million, which I think, if it's technical problems with student loans or adjusting or whatever, 46 million for the funding council, 30 million under learning, and 13 for children and families, are all areas which have experienced quite significant cuts over the last few years. I mean, are you concerned that this underspend is too hefty?
Well, Alison might want to talk about underspend. I think in the context of the overall budget, it is relatively small sums, but I think you heard earlier from Alison our efforts to try and make sure that we squeeze every single pound out of our allocated funding within each year is a high priority for us. That's not always at our hand. It's not always possible when people are not ready or are not able to take down funding from grant schemes that we're producing and so on. But I don't know if you want to say something more about it.
No, I think that's the distinction between areas that have funds that are allocated to support the running of services, and those obviously go out on a regular profile, and those areas where we actually are reliant on uptake, whether that's from communities or local authorities or particular interest groups. And I think, you know, that's some of the dynamic that we always have to work through with any budget in any one year, whether that's at the aggregate level overall or for those portfolios that actually have particular areas that, you know, that those that you've focused on yourself.
Okay, thank you. I'd like to move to EU structural funds. Paragraph 76 identifies that £14 million being permanently lost to the Scottish Government's budget. Can you make any comment on that?
I understand what's said in the report. I think we're not clear yet whether that £14 million will be lost. There are two reasons around that. One is the complete reconciliation doesn't actually take place until 2018. So this is part of a seven-year programme, and we would need, there's quite a lot of work being done, not just by us, but by Europe, still to happen next year. So we won't know for sure what the final outturn for this programme and therefore what the reconciliation is until 2018 by Europe.
That's interesting, because Audit Scotland seemed quite clear. They say in the report that a provision of £14 million to reflect permanent loss of grant to the Scottish Government, which it cannot now recover.
Well, the other point I was going to make it is it may be possible, though we don't know yet. So we don't know what the final figures will be. We don't know yet whether we may be able to claw back some elements of that funding, although we can't be sure about that at the moment, but from the project sponsors. So not from the projects themselves, but the project sponsors who are responsible for overseeing how these programmes are carried out, how they're managed and so on. So there may well be that we're able to reclaim some of that funding through there, but we're not sure at the moment. We're working on that at the moment.
Okay.
So the 14 million is there as a marker, which we don't want to assume we wouldn't need to draw down, but it may not be that amount of money.
Okay. So Audit Scotland, in their opinion, are saying it's not recoverable quite clearly from their report, but you're saying it might be?
It might be.
Okay. The evidence we heard on this earlier from Audit Scotland, they were talking about the chain of places where this money is drawn down from Scottish Government through local authorities, through grants and all these different organisations. Are you aware of where the errors are occurring that this money is going astray?
We know where most of them are occurring. They're occurring very much at the front line. As you say, it's quite a long chain, which involves Europe, which involves the Scottish Government, which involves project sponsors, so, as you say, local authorities and so on, and actually the projects themselves, which are the ones doing the work at the front line and providing some very important and impactful work. So we have to be aware in working with all that part of the chain of who needs to know what and what skills need to be available in each part of that chain. And actually some of the work that we're doing for the new programme is very much intended to learn from what didn't go very well in the 14-20 programme. We do know, for example, that it's very rare in terms of the audit material that we're seeing that people are deliberately trying to use the money for, you know, in unintended consequences, unintended purposes. What we do know is often it's to do with recording, particularly to do with things like recording people's time. So when you're working half on a project which is ESF funded and half on a project which might be getting funding from your local authority or another source, you have to be able to show Europe how that split takes place. Recording that information and being able to produce that paperwork digitally or otherwise on the day that the auditor appears is how you are tested of whether or not you're complying with some of these quite rigorous.
But I mean, it's your responsibility, isn't it, to put these arrangements in place to make sure this reporting is being done properly?
It's our responsibility to ensure that programme sponsors and indeed projects are able to and aware of their responsibilities. So for the next set, we are doing a lot more work now on the training and the guidance that is required for project sponsors and for the projects themselves, so they understand what they're taking on in these projects. Secondly, we're doing more on checking and audit visits so we know earlier on. And thirdly, we're going to be looking earlier on in the pipeline about whether or not the quality of information that's being recorded and shared is actually available for the audits when they come in, because they come in at various times during the year and they're random samples, of course.
But Ms. Evans, with respect, you said exactly the same to the committee last year. You said it is my role to make it very clear to those who are in receipt of the funding that they must continue to put in place the measures that are required to ensure there is accountability to that funding and that the public pound is tracked. I mean, have you seen any improvement in this over the last year since you said that?
I've heard that there is greater understanding of what the role is. I think the issue is that we're coming to the end of a set of projects now. So we're now actually looking at closing these projects down, as we have been doing for the work that's been described in the report, and creating the next set of projects, learning from people's skills and capacities to be able to manage European funding. We spoke to all of the key, personally and in writing last year, to all of the key programme managers, which included people like Glasgow Council, Scottish Enterprise, I mean, big establishments, about their capacity to ensure that their projects, which they had initiated, could comply with what are quite onerous, and rightly so because it's public money, onerous responsibilities in recording. So we will continue to remind them of their responsibilities. The other thing we've done...
Do you think there has been an improvement, though, over the last year?
I think there is a greater awareness of the responsibilities and requirements now. Yes,
because
I don't think there's a greater awareness.
Any of these bodies, you mentioned Glasgow City Council or Scottish Enterprise, would want to lose such significant sums of money.
Indeed. And in fact, when we worked with Scottish Enterprise, and I spoke to the Chief Executive personally about it, when I first came in as Permanent Secretary last year, she had taken some very rapid and robust steps to improve the governance and the recording of the projects under their auspices.
I mean, this is a problem that dates back to 2010-11. It was identified as a problem in the Auditor General's report then. I mean, why hasn't this got better over 6 years?
Well, we won't know what the final outturn, of course, in terms of the final errors and therefore penalties that may have to be paid for a little bit longer. We don't know that yet. And we also know that we may have the opportunity to recoup some of this money. So the final outturn is still awaiting. I don't think we can deny that it is challenging and tough for very small organisations, often some of them embedded in communities that have not...
But Glasgow City Council and Scottish Enterprise are not small organisations.
They're not, but the projects that they are managing are very frequently very small. Some of them will be in your own constituencies, and as I said, doing some splendid work. But if you've got small groups of people who are doing really important work on the front line, they won't necessarily have either the time or the experience of collating and producing information that is suitable for a robust audit. That is what the programme sponsors have been encouraging their projects to understand and learn.
So you're saying that there are errors occurring in small organisations, but also large established organisations like Glasgow City Council and Scottish Enterprise?
Well, there is a slightly different relationship there. The project sponsors tend to be the big institutions. There are a number of projects that they will have as sponsors, many of which will be very small. So the project sponsors have to be convinced when they take these projects on, when they agree to the funding, that those often small-scale projects are able to have the experience and the capacity to be able to make the kind of recording that allows the project sponsors to make their returns to us and to Europe.
It looks to me as if there are long-term institutional weaknesses with the way the Scottish Government deals with EU funding. Would you agree?
No, I wouldn't. I think we
Why
are...
Why are we losing £14 million?
We aren't necessarily losing £14 million, though we will still... The jury is out on whether that's the case or not. And in fact, every project that is funded by Europe under ESF does lose some element of funding anyway. Some of them in Europe, up to 40%. I think our record is we retain at least 90% of our funding. I think the UK as a whole is between 80 and 90%. I'm not saying that we are complacent. There is no room for that. What I am saying is it's important that we learn, and we have learned from the most recent project, that we put that into place in revised conditions, practices, guidance, and expectations. And importantly, one of them will be, we will know earlier on if there are issues coming up in these small projects, because the audit process will be highlighting them earlier on in the system before it comes to the reporting end of the reporting end of the programme, by which time it's almost too late.
Are you happy with the progress that's been made on this over the last 6 years?
I can't comment on the last 6 years. I've been responsible for this for the last...
the last year, then?
I think there is more to be done, undoubtedly, but I think people have a greater understanding of their expectations, not least working very closely with internal auditors about what is expected of the capacity and also the quality of reporting that needs to be available.
OK. I'm interested in the point that you think some of this £14 million is recoverable. Could you write to the committee when you receive information about that and let us know how much you've managed to recover?
I shall.
Thank you. Could you also follow up on the attainment issues?
Yes,
that
I have a
raised?
Note of that.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Are there any further questions from members? Can I thank you very much indeed for your evidence this morning? I now move the committee into private session as previously agreed.